every country around the world, you are welcome to join the movement that is touching the world. Let's reach the world together. Welcome, my friends, to 1billion.org. You know, here at 1 Billion, we exist to share the hope of Jesus with millions, and we share the gospel through commercials on mobile phones in over 192 nations. And today, God's gonna speak to you. My friend, Pastor Andrew, has a message today, and we're in a new series called The Year of Discipleship. So today's message is titled, Who is God? So get ready, this is the Bible.
Before meeting Jesus, I felt frustrated. Nothing I had was enough. These feelings changed when I started telling God everything that worried me. Now I'm satisfied and I have peace and hope that things will go well in my life. Asking God to help me when I'm worried has changed everything. He is looking forward to hearing from you.
Welcome to church and happy 2021 to you. I know that we've all been through the dumpster fire, which was 2020, and we're excited to have a brand new start. We are going to be doing a new series. Now, this is an exciting one. Normally, a series would be a 4-week series or a 6-week series. This is a 52-week series. I think it's the most monumental project we've done as a church yet. And we're going to be focusing this year on one idea. One word. Can you guess what it is? Discipleship. When I was praying about this new series, I said, God, what do you want to do? And he said, you know what? It's amazing to follow God or to be saved by God, but it's a whole different thing to be transformed by God. You know, in the Great Commission, God talks about making disciples of all nations and teaching his ways. And that's what we want to do. We want to take this time and say, God, we want your ways, not our ways. We don't want our tradition. We want you to level it. We don't want religion. We want to level it. We want to do things your way. It's time to start fresh. So in this series, we're going to do it in 4 stages just to break it up a little bit, because 52 straight would be a little crazy. So the first 3 months, we're going to be talking about the foundation stage. This is where we're going to go over topics like today, who is God, or why am I here, or the Bible and prayer. How do I read the Bible? How do I pray? You know, these are all things that we need to learn. And for some of you, you might be tuning in saying, but I already know all that stuff. Well, there's always more to learn with God. So I would encourage you not to skip ahead in the series, but to take it week by week. The next 3 months, we're going to talk about the growing stage. Now, the growing stage is how to have a quiet time, how to read and study the Bible in depth, and how to cultivate a grateful and joyful heart so that your circumstances and your emotions don't dictate your actions. This is where it's gonna get a little uncomfortable and we're gonna step outside of our comfort zone, but we're going to be so happy that we did, because God is going to start molding and shaping us. Next, we're gonna go into another 3 months of the maturing stage. Now, this one's gonna be a little bit tougher. This is surrendering your past, present, and future to God. This is writing and sharing your testimony online. So that's where you're taking that step. We're gonna learn how to overcome temptation and live without compromise. We're gonna learn how to love others through service. We're going to do even more in-depth Bible study techniques, and we're gonna navigate hard times with God. It's so important, because anytime you make forward movement, the enemy wants to push you back. So we're gonna give you tools and tactics on how to move forward with God even when hard times are happening. And finally, the stage that I am most excited about, and I know Jordan is excited about, is the sending stage. This is where we find out how to get God's direction for your life. This is where we discover what ministry is and the 3 healthy components. This is where we discover how to find your calling, how to share the gospel, how to prepare sermons and give messages that inspire and motivate people to grow in God. And finally, you'll be challenged to share the gospel online. Yes, you are going to be sharing the gospel. You know, every member of this church is a minister. You're not here just to sit still while I instill. You weren't called to come here and sit. You were called to go. And we want to empower you to go in this year. First, we're going to talk about the foundation stage. Each one of these stages has desired outcomes. There's things that we want you to be able to know and do by the time it's done, or else what's the purpose? That's why we created this 52-week series, because we wanted to be specific. We wanted to have a specific course to discipleship. We wanted to show you where to go. So here are the desired outcomes for our first 3 months. Are you ready? The first one is that you would know God, His deep love for you, and His plans for mankind. Second, we want you to be confident in your salvation, that you have been accepted by God. We don't want you to ever guess whether God loves you or He wants to slug you. You are accepted and God loves you, and we want you to have this strong foundation for the rest of your Christian walk. You'll never have to guess again whether you've been accepted by God. Next, you have to know what the Bible is, where it came from, and how you know it's true. This is important because your faith is going to be tested and people are going to want to know what you believe and why you believe it. We're going to learn the other desired outcome is to talk to God and to hear from God. You know, we talk to God through prayer and we hear from God through reading the scripture and hearing His voice. Next, I want you to know who you are and what your identity in Christ is. There's so many things that God wants to say to you about who you are. Not what the world says you are, but who God says you are. We're going to learn some of God's promises. We're going to begin to learn some of the basic promises of God, and we're going to start to memorize some of those verses. So when you're going through a hard time, you can engage with God's word and fight against the enemy. Finally, the last two things, you're going to understand why you're here. That's the biggest question we all have is, why am I here? What's my purpose for living? And I guarantee you, you're going to find that in this stage. Next is the most important, how to love God and others. We want you to love God like you've never loved God before. And we want you to be transformed and be so selfless that people see you and say, you know what? That person follows Jesus Christ. That's a Christian. So first, let's go into our first thing that we're going to teach, and that's, who is God? It's a big loaded question, but I'm going to do my best to give you a head start. Now, I can't possibly say all the things that there are to know about God, but there is one way that you can be guaranteed to learn more and more each day, and that's to read the Word of God. That's where we discover who God is. He wrote the Bible so that you could know Him more. In fact, when you open and read your Bible, that's the purpose for Bible study. It's not to find out who you are, it's to find out who God is. And as you do that, you learn more about yourself. You learn more about the world and about others and how to love. So let's go ahead and start on this message. Who is God? I know that there's a lot of things that I'm going to share, and so to make it easy, I made an acrostic. So we're gonna do it C-H-A-R, yes, I'm spelling it right, A-C-T-E-R, and each one is going to have a word. So by the end of this teaching, you can write these down and put them on the inside of your Bible. That way, as you go to read, you can always be reminded who God is, and you can always add some more. Remember, this isn't an exhaustive list. So let's start with C. God is the creator. God is the creator. In Genesis 1:1, perfect way to start, right? It says that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And that's in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, in Colossians 1:16, it says, through Him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. Everything was created through Him and for Him. So God is the ultimate creator. Why is that important? Because God created you with a plan. God created you with a plan and an intention. In fact, this is what God says in Psalm 139, verse 16. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. So before you were even born into existence, God knew you and God loved you. He had a plan for your life. If you don't believe me, let's read what Jeremiah says. Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not disaster, to give you a hope and a future. God has good plans for you. So how do I discover God's purpose for my life? How do I know what I was created for? You know, only the creator of an invention can tell you its purpose. It's like when you buy a car Every time you buy a new car, it comes with an instruction manual. And the people that made that car put together the instruction manual to tell you how it best operates. But the problem is, many people don't read the manual. Nobody, you know, says, let's go and do some light nighttime reading before bed. Let's learn about the transmission. Let's learn about the brake system. People just kind of figure it out as they go. But with us, we can know what God's plan is for our life. And we have the Bible as our instruction manual. In fact, 2 Timothy 3:16 says this, everything in the scriptures is God's word. All of it is useful for teaching and helping people and for correcting them and showing them how to live. It's like knowing how to run a car. The Bible is here to show you how to live, and it can show you and teach you why you were created. Next, H. H stands for holy. God is set apart above everything else. So I have a question for you. What is your most prized possession? What's something that you absolutely love more than anything else? You know, for me, I have a piece of art that I love. And because it's so precious to me, I put it in a frame and I put it on the wall so that it couldn't get damaged and it wouldn't fall down. I made sure to screw it in nice and tight. And the reason for having the art on the wall is so that I can look at its beauty and I can enjoy it every single day. And I could sit there in awe and wonder as I'm looking at the lines and the scenery in this piece of art, in this painting. And it's the same thing with God. God is the most prized possession you could have in your life. So it's important that we place him in that place like we do that painting. So it's important that we put him in his proper place, just like that painting, so that we can be in awe and wonder. God does so many good things. And I know that as you go through this series, you're going to discover God doing amazing things in your life. This is what the Bible says about God being holy. In Psalm 86:8, it says, "There is no one like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours." It's like that painting. There's no works like God's works. It's the most beautiful masterpiece. Think about every sunset. It's different. Think about the night sky with all the stars. Nobody else could create that. God is set apart because he can do things that nobody else can do. 1 Samuel 2:22 says, "There's none holy like the Lord. There is none beside you. There is no rock like our God." Jeremiah says something similar. Have you noticed the pattern in these words? "There is no one like you, O Lord." See, he is set apart. That's what it means to be holy. "You are great, and great is your name in might." So here's what I want to say to you about God being holy. No one can save you like he can. No one can love you like he can, and no one can rescue you like he can. He is all powerful. He is all knowing, and he can be there with you in your greatest challenges, but also in those beautiful moments where you're doing well. So remember, God is the creator and he's holy. Next, A. He is a God of order, variety, and detail. God is a God of order, which is actually helpful to us because life can get crazy sometimes. It's good to know that someone's manning the ship here. He ordered creation into 7 days. Did you notice that? He could have just spoke it into existence at once, but God actually ordered creation in 7 days with a specific order. First, he had to create day and night. Then he had to create land and sea so that he could fill them with birds and animals and fish that swim. So God had an order. He made all the plants and animals also according to its kind. That's another way that God is a God of order. Genesis 1:11 says, "Then God said, let the land produce vegetation." Isn't that amazing? It's like, poof, there's lettuce. "Seed-bearing plants and trees on the land according to their various kinds." Notice that word, various kinds. In Genesis 1:25, it says, "God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good." So, what's the purpose of order? Why does God do things in order? Because order brings peace. 1 Corinthians 14:33 says, "God does not want us to be in disorder, but in harmony and peace." And here's another thing to notice about God's order. It wasn't meant to be broken. If you mate a horse and a donkey and you put them together, do you know what it produces? It produces a sterile mule. It can't produce offspring. Why? Because you're breaking God's order. Today, many people don't want to follow God's order. We have the breaking of God's moral law, which produces sin and death. We have the abortion and the killing of innocent children. We have sex before marriage, and all of these things lead to brokenness. And that's where we find ourselves right now. But what I want us to do is realize God's order is good, and there's a reason for it. So if we start to follow God's order, we can have peace and harmony in our lives. Next, God loves variety and detail. Genesis 1:29 says, "Then God said, 'Behold, I have given you every,'" notice the word every "seed-bearing plant on the face of the earth, and every tree that has fruit." So, you know, I did a little research. I wanted to figure out how many trees are there in the world. Well, I found out there were 60,000 varieties of trees. So how many can you name? You might be able to say there's palm tree, eucalyptus, all these other ones, but there are 60,000 species of trees. You know what else is crazy? There's over 8.7 million types of animals. 8.7. God wasn't just satisfied with the cat and the dog. He's like, let's add 8 more million to it. And there are over 7.8 billion unique people on the earth, each with a distinct eye print and thumbprint, a distinct heartbeat, a distinct eye print. You know, and the crazy thing is even twins don't have the same DNA. There's a variety of skin tones, eye colors, hair colors, languages, accents, styles. This is God's masterpiece, and He is a God of variety. Let's talk about detail. Luke 12:7 says this, "Even the hairs on your head have all been counted." Isn't that crazy? Think about all the details that God has worked on. Your eyebrows are there so sweat doesn't get into your eyes. Our tongue has 2,000 to 8,000 different taste buds, so we can detect even the slightest hint of sourness or sweetness or bitterness. And your body, check this out, has over 30 trillion separate cells. Now that's detail. So why is detail important? Why is it important to know that God loves order, variety, and detail? Because God cares about every detail of your life. God cares about when you're sleeping and when you're awake. He cares about the times where you're so happy you can't contain it, and the times when you're in the valley and you're crying out for a savior. God loves you and He cares about you. Next, R, righteous and just. God is righteous and just. God is always right and just. Deuteronomy 32:4 says, "His work is perfect, for all of His ways are just. A God of faithfulness and without injustice, righteous and upright is He." You know, God, one of the ways that God demonstrated His righteousness was through the life of His Son, Jesus Christ. Colossians 1:15 says, "He is the image," talking about Jesus, "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation." 1 Peter 2:22 says, this is about Jesus, "He never sinned and He never told a lie." So Jesus was the representation of His Father. If you want to know what the Father is like, look at what Jesus is like, because He came to be a perfect representation of His Father. So a question for you, why did God send His Son to earth? Why do you think God sent His Son to earth? To die for our sins so that we could become right with God. Remember, we're talking about God's righteousness and justice. Jesus literally came so that we could be right with Him. And then the next question that I get asked a lot as a pastor, why did He have to die on a cross? Why did Jesus have to die on a cross? Because sin has to be judged. God is loving, but He's also just, which means that every sin and every wrongdoing has to be punished. So God already knew somebody had to pay for all of this. So what God did was He sent His Son Jesus to come stand next to you. And He took the sin off of you and He placed it on His Son and had His Son die in your place. Why? Because somebody had to pay. And God didn't want to see you go to hell. He wanted to see you be a part of His family. He wanted to be with you forever, and He loves you. A lot of people think that, you know, it's unfair that, you know, every unrighteous thing must be judged. But what if one of your loved ones or family members was murdered? They would want their killer, you know, to be found guilty and go to jail, and they would want to see justice you know, happen. And for some reason that's fair, but it's not fair when God does it. It doesn't make any sense. This is part of God's character. You know, all sin must be judged. Next, let's go to A, for all-powerful, knowing, and present. God is all-knowing. He knows everything. There's nothing that you can hide from God. Psalm 139, verse 4 shows this. It says, even before a word is on my tongue, remember the one with 2,000 to 8,000 taste buds, behold, O Lord, you know it all together. You know everything before we say it. What a comfort it is to know that God understands your pain, your weaknesses, your needs, and all that you go through. He cares about all of it, and he understands it, and he knows. God is also present with you. He's always with you. Isaiah 41:10 says this, fear not, fear not. Isn't that a great word for this year? Fear not, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Not only that, not only is God all-knowing and always with you, but he's all-powerful, which brings us a, you know, great comfort. Luke chapter 1 verse 37 says, for nothing is impossible with God. God can do anything in your life at any moment. I want to repeat that. God can do anything in your life at any moment. If you're in a really tough spot right now, with a snap of the finger, God can lift you up. God could bring you out of the pit, and he could put you on a solid foundation again. So my question to you is, what impossible situation do you need God to come through on in your life? What impossible situation are you going through right now? You can know that God is all powerful and he's with you and he knows everything. He's gonna come to your rescue, just like he did with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You know, they were in front of King Nebuchadnezzar. He was an evil king. And he said, you know what, you have to bow down to me. But these three boys didn't want to dishonor God. So they refused. They said, we're not going to bow down to you. We trust in God. And we can see all three of these characteristics in Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You know, God knew, he knows everything, right? He knew that they wouldn't bow to the king ahead of time. God was with them in the fire. And thirdly, God was able to deliver them from the fire, even without a single hair on their head being singed. Next, let's talk about C, compassionate and loving. This is so important, and this is one of the key characteristics of who God is. And you know, one of the this is also one of the things that we struggle with the most. Why is that? Because I think the enemy wants to turn that and make us think that God is mad at us. And that's something that I don't want you to have to struggle with anymore. I want you to know without a shadow of a doubt that God is compassionate and loving and in love with you. In fact, 1 John 4:8 says, God is love. God is love. He's not just loving, he is love. And the Bible tells us what real love is. It's patient. It's kind. It doesn't envy or boast. It's not proud. It doesn't dishonor others. It's not self-seeking. God isn't self-seeking either. He cares about you. He's not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love doesn't delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. Love, just like God, never fails. He is compassionate. He's not just loving, he's compassionate. What's the difference? Compassion is love in action. I'll say that again. Compassion is love in action. It's not enough to say, I love you. You also have to show it. You know, that's called lip service. That's what we call lip service. It's like, oh, I love you so much. It's like, well, you don't show me you love me, so I don't believe it. But with God, he shows us that he loves us. It's more important what he does with his actions than what he does with his words. But he does both. He says, for God so loved the world. This is John 3:16. This is a scripture to memorize. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, so that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. God sent his only son. He didn't have anything money. That's what he did, but way crazier. You know, he just said, you know, I love you so much, I'm gonna give everything. Not only that, but God has loved us at our worst. That's real love. Romans 5:8 says, but God shows his love for us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. In the middle of our mess, Jesus Christ came to earth and died for our sins so that we could have salvation. You know, a question that I get asked a lot too is, you know, does God say I love you in the Bible? We hear about God sending his son to earth and, you know, we hear about all the amazing things he does, but does he actually say the words I love you to you? The answer is yes. There's two places out of many in the Bible. The first one is in Isaiah 43:4. It says, you are precious to me. You are honored and I love you. I want you to accept that I love you today. Sometimes when people say I love you, we don't accept it. We don't take it to heart. But today I want you to take that to heart, and I'm taking that to heart, that God loves me and God loves you. Next, in Jeremiah 31:3, it says, the Lord appeared to him from far away. I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, I have continued my faithfulness to you. God didn't just love you once. He loves you over and over and over again. So my question for you today, what has kept you from embracing God's love for you? Is there a certain guilt in your life? Is there a certain sin that you don't believe God could forgive? What lies have you believed that have kept you from accepting that God loves you? Next, let's move on to T. T stands for three in one, or Trinity. God is three persons in one. Now that can sound super confusing, but let me help you with that. There's distinct roles for all three, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and they work together. Imagine three people holding hands in a circle. It's an unbreakable circle, but it has three separate individuals, so it's three in one. So how do they relate to each other and what are their roles? Well, the Father creates a plan. So the Father is the mastermind. He's the protector. He is the provider. Next, Jesus Christ implements the plan. He goes to work and does it. And the Holy Spirit administers the plan. We see this in creation. You know, the creation was made through the Father's command. Genesis 1:3, you know, God said, let there be light, and there was light. That was the Father's role. But what about Jesus? Was Jesus born when he came to earth? Or did he exist before that? Well, the Bible tells us in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, that's Jesus Christ, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So it shows us that Jesus he's actually God, and he was with the Father at creation. So that leaves the Holy Spirit. What was the Holy Spirit doing at creation? Well, Genesis 1:2 says, now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. So here we see all three of the Trinity at work. They work together and they love each other. Now let's go to E, ever gracious and merciful. Psalm 86:15 says it best. But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Get that, slow to anger. God is slow to anger. In fact, that's why the Bible is so long. Have you read through the Bible and seen all the times that people went against God's way and against God's word? When God made a commandment and then they ran the exact opposite way, you know, it's like Jonah. He's like, go over to the great city of Nineveh. And he's like, I'm going the other way. And he got swallowed by a fish. You know, we always mess it up over and over and over. And it's like, I'm just thankful I haven't been swallowed by a fish. So why is the Bible so long? Because God is so merciful and gracious. He could have ended it at the first flood, but he gave us a rainbow in the sky. And he said, this is a promise that I'm never going to destroy the earth again. So what's the difference between mercy and grace? It's important to know. Mercy is not getting what you deserve. It's like if you were caught to be guilty and you were going to go to jail and someone said, you know what? I'm going to do your time for you. That's mercy. And that's one of the most powerful characteristics of who God is. Next, grace, getting what you don't deserve. It means that you just get all the benefits and blessings without having to work for it. That's the best part about being a Christian. God has shown me over and over that my works can't get me to heaven. There's nothing that I can do. And I'm a type A driven personality. So if there was a way to get to heaven, I would find it and work for it. But time and time again, God has slowed me down and reminded me, you can't earn it, you don't deserve it, just accept my grace. And we're going to talk about that in the coming weeks, how to know what grace is and how to have salvation. The final one here, so we went through character, the R is relational. You know, God made you for one purpose, to love you. God literally made you for relationship with Him. He made you to love you. And you know why you exist? You exist to enjoy and love Him back. That is your main priority. 1 John 3:1 says, "See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God." And so we are. God wants a family. In fact, when you became a Christian, you now magically had 2.5 billion brothers and sisters. 1 in 3 people walking the earth today is a Christian, or they say that they're a Christian. So we have a big family. God wants a big family. He wants many children. John 1:10 through 13 says this, "He was in the world, and the world was made through Him, yet the world did not know Him. He came to His own, and His own people did not receive Him." How sad is that? He makes a world for everybody, and they don't want to receive Him. "But to all who did receive Him, who believed in His name, He gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." So my final question to you today is, have you started a relationship with God? How do you do it? Well, there's 4 steps to starting a relationship, and Jordan is going to share those with you next. So let's recap. Who is God? That was the topic for today's message. And remember, we had an acronym, character. So let's recap who He is. God, first, is the Creator. C stands for Creator. Next, God is holy. He's set apart. We talked about God as a God of order, variety, and detail. Also, He is righteous and just. Remember, every sin has to be punished, but God sent His Son to make the payment. He's all-powerful, knowing, and present, so He knows what you're going through today. He is compassionate and loving. Remember the difference between love and compassion. Love is who God is. Compassionate is when God puts that to action, love in action. He is Trinitarian, which means He is 3 in 1. He's ever merciful and gracious. And most importantly, He is a God that's relational and loves you. I can't wait to see you next week as we continue on in this series.
I used to be sad, but now, after accepting Jesus Christ, I have peace, joy, and love. Jesus came to die on a cross to give me a brand new start. Now He is with me, and I am not alone. I want everyone to know God. He changed my life, and He can change yours too. Jesus loves you.
Andrew just shared with you a message about how to know God. Well, today, if you're in that place and you want to know God, I want to share these 4 steps to knowing God. Number 1 is love. Number 2 is sin. Number 3 is Jesus. And lastly, number 4 is pray. So let's open the Bible together and go through these 4 steps. So number 1 is love. Do you know that God loves you so much? It says this in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, Jesus Christ, that whoever believes in Him will not perish, but have eternal life." Today, you can have eternal life, my friends. So that brings us to step number 2, is sin. You see, sin separates us from God. And the Bible says that we're all sinful and separated. It says this in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory." That's the bad news. But the good news is this, that 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ came and died on a cross for you. He died in your place. He died for all your sins. He took upon your sin upon Himself, and He died in your place. And we read about this in Romans 6:23. It says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord." So only in Jesus Christ can we have the free gift of eternal life. And the good news is that this eternal life is free for anyone who believes. So if you want to believe in Jesus today, you want to give Him your life, that brings us to step number 4, is to pray. We can pray to receive the hope of eternal life, the grace of God, the forgiveness of our sins, and a new life in Jesus. So let's pray right now, wherever you're at. This is the most important decision you will ever make in life. So let's pray right now. Dear God, we come before You. Today, I give You my life. I believe in what Jesus did, that God sent His Son, Jesus, to die on a cross in my place. I believe that He died for all of my sins, my past, my present, and my future sins. I repent today of all my sins. Forgive me, wash me clean, and make me new. And I ask, Holy Spirit, that you come into my life and fill me with your power and your presence, and help me to live for you from this day forward. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, amen, my friends. The Bible says that if you receive God's hope, a Savior, his name is Jesus Christ today, your sins are forgiven, you are made new, you're a new creation, and you have a home in heaven. God bless. Unreached people are those who have never heard the name of Jesus or met a Christian. They live in closed countries where Christianity is persecuted. Does this make them impossible to reach? Now with OneBillion.org, you can reach across borders and reach people's hearts through mobile phones. And you don't even have to leave your home. It's simple. Chat with a OneBillion.org team member today and customize your global outreach. You can even pick the country too. Do you have a passion for Jesus? Are you looking to start a ministry of your own? Are you also wanting to know how God can use you to touch and reach your nation? Well, we're excited for you to become a missionary at OneBillion.org. You know, at OneBillion, we exist to share the gospel with 1 billion people.
That's right. And over the past 2 years, Jordan and I have traveled to 24 countries. We actually filmed 170 videos, which is crazy to think about, in 40 different languages. And every day, thousands of people are watching these videos and hundreds are coming to Christ. But now we want to take what we've learned and we want to give it to you.
Since we officially launched in 2018, over 60 million people have seen a 1 billion video ad online. 30 million people have heard the gospel, and over 175,000 people have received Christ into their life.
And now we want to teach you how to reach your nation for Christ with the gospel, but how is that possible?
Andrew and I want to send you a kit. Now this kit is so amazing because it comes with a 4K camera, and with this camera you can film testimonies in your nation to reach people, thousands of people online for Christ every day.
So how does it work? Well, the first step is you receive your equipment, you unpack it, you shoot the videos, and then you upload it to OneBillion.org. There, we're gonna edit it, put it online, and people are gonna start responding to Christ. Are you interested in becoming a missionary to your nation?
If you are, fill out an application. And also, if you want, you can send us an email at info@onebillion.org. We're excited to be working with you. We can't wait. It's going to be amazing. God bless.
God bless.
I want to share Jesus with people, but it's hard to share Jesus because we live in a digital age. Everyone's on their phone and online. It's so hard to share the gospel in person. LinkU.co gives me the ability to share Jesus with anyone and everyone, 24/7, right from my phone. I created my own personal Jesus link, and now I can reach the world and see my impact daily. The best part is I don't have to create my own gospel. I can install gospel presentations from one of my favorite ministries. Today, I'm reaching TikTok, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and more. I've already shared Jesus with 1,000 people today and saw 16 people say yes to Jesus. I am so excited because now I have a ministry of my own and God is moving through my life. If you know anyone who wants to share Jesus, tell them to get their link, linku.co.
This section is called Miracles because we believe and know that God can do anything at any moment. So I want to go ahead and pray with you. Let's go ahead and bow our heads and close our eyes. And let's begin to just acknowledge God's presence. So Jesus, I just say thank you for my friends and my family that have tuned in today from wherever they're at. God, you know exactly what they're going through today. You know their exact situation. Whether it's going through a sickness or a loss or a broken relationship, God, you are perfect in all of your ways. And you know exactly what it is they need. In fact, in your word, Lord, you say that you are all-knowing and all-present and all-powerful. So we just call on those character traits of yours today, Lord. And we just ask you to do a miracle in the lives of my friends today. God, touch them where they need your special touch. And Holy Spirit, would you come and would you just fill them with life? Would you fill them with your joy? Would you continue to give them strength to live each and every day for you? God, I love you and I thank you and I'm so excited that you're with us and that you're carrying us through this journey of life. And we pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, God bless you, friends, and can't wait to see you next week.
I'm a pastor kid. This makes me live in a great social pressure and a lot of pressure to look good. Since I met Jesus personally, He healed me and now I don't regret live as a pastor kid. And actually, I'm grateful for the chance to live as a pastor kid because I can get to know Jesus better now. I want everyone to meet and know Jesus so He can heal and save you.
So we have a few testimonies that have come in all over the world today on 1billion.org. You know, we're reaching millions of people on mobile phones for Christ. And here I want to share with you a few of these testimonies that have come in today. Yeah, we have a man from Cairo, Egypt. He says, "Yes, I just received Jesus Christ as my Savior." Well, God bless you for that. You know, Jesus is the Savior of the world, and we're so excited that you accepted Jesus. We have a woman from Liberia. "I recommitted my life to Christ. I want to see Jesus and meet Him in my home." Well, God bless. You know, God is with you today, wherever you go. Even if you are in your home or even out of your home, God is there with you because you have Christ in your life. We also have another man from the Philippines. He says, "I just received Jesus Christ. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life." Well, praise God, you've got that right. We also have another woman from Cameroon. She says, "I just received Jesus Christ. I accept Jesus Christ." Well, praise God. The greatest decision you can make in life is to receive the hope of Jesus Christ. We have another man from UAE in Abu Dhabi. He says, "Pray for me. I believe I've done a lot of bad sins in my life that have set me apart from God. I want to be close to God. I need His forgiveness for the sins I've done." We will be praying for you. You know, God does forgive you of your past, your present, even your future sins when you choose to believe in Jesus. So we'll be praying for you as a 1 billion family that God will move in your life. And lastly, we have a woman from the Philippines. She says, "I want to start a Bible group. Thank you for this wonderful site. I have given my life to Jesus and it's been a wonderful message to hear." Well, praise God for you. We're going to be sending you Bible instructions of how you can start that Bible study. And you know, this month alone, we've shared the gospel with over 970,000 people. Over 21 million people have seen our gospel commercials. And the best part is that people were saved. 6,251 people gave their life to Jesus. Praise God.
No matter how much you mess up or think you don't deserve forgiveness, I learned you're never too far to reach out to Jesus. It took me coming to a foreign land to realize and experience God's love and forgiveness. I want everyone to know that Jesus loves you however you are. All He asks is to come as you are. Jesus loves you.
As we wrap up today, this last section is called You, because you matter to God. And not only that, but God has given you a ministry. And here at 1 Billion, our goal is to equip you for your ministry, whatever God has called you to do. So I want to share with you one of our websites that will help train you. It's called the7steps.org. And this is a basic foundation course of 7 steps of how you can grow in your faith. We also have another website called 1billion.org/go. And if you want to be a missionary in your country, you want to reach your country for Christ, we want you to become a video missionary. That means we want to equip you with camera so you can go out and film testimonies, and we can use those as commercials on the 1billion.org network. And then lastly, every Sunday we have a church service, which you're probably watching right now. Go to 1billion.org/live. Every Sunday, we have new messages that are coming out, and we're actually in the year of discipleship, and we've got some amazing messages coming your way, so stay tuned every Sunday for that. But before we go, let me pray for you that God would move in your life. So dear God, we thank you for our friends and family all over the world that are watching and listening today. Would you bless them? Would you be with them? May they feel your presence right now. And Father, we ask Holy Spirit that you'd empower them to live for you every day this week. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, amen, my friends. We'll see you next week, next Sunday, right here on 1billion.org. God bless.
You and I are living in the biggest communication shift in 2,000 years.
Amazon has no stores. Uber owns almost no cars. Facebook creates no content. Airbnb owns no real estate. And Netflix is not a TV channel. The way people hear about Jesus is also changing too. OneBillion.org is on the cutting edge of delivering Jesus to the masses through social media and smartphones. Its plan is to give every person on earth and every nation the opportunity to come to Jesus right on their smartphone. And we also want to do it 1 billion times. Think about it. We want to share Jesus with 1 billion people. OneBillion.org has been paid for by ministry partners like you. If you'd like to be a part of the ministry and join us as a partner, you can at OneBillion.org. And you can see lives impacted by our program. God bless you.